So I'd like you to imagine a cake. Are you imagining a cake? Good. Better still, let's use a cake, shall we?
Look, and I've even got a sign for you.
Two candles and one cake. So that is the new puzzle. The puzzle was originally set without a cake. It was a stick. I've deliberately got a linear cake. We have two candles. I like your choice of candles. These are fresh candles, unlit, and they're both blue. That might be important later on that we can't tell the difference. Although, spoiler alert, it's not going to be that important. And the puzzle is very simple, Brady. I would like you to imagine that the candles are placed randomly on the cake. There should be a klaxon going off. Like, what do I mean by random? But I will tell you, I mean uniformly, randomly on a line along this cake. I don't care about the sideways movement. Like, imagine there's a line along the center. The candles go in somewhere. If I wanted to do it, simulate it, maybe I could generate a random number from 0 to 1 in some uniform way and use that to mark how far on. So maybe that one goes there and this one goes somewhere else randomly there. The puzzle now comes when you pick up a knife and you say, the cut of this cake, we're going to split it into two portions, happens also randomly. If I cut it here, then I'm not too worried about the unequal pieces. We'll just deal with the aftermath of that another day. The point I want to talk about this time is that there is not a candle on each piece. So the question becomes now a probability question. If the candles go on randomly and the cut is done randomly, what are the chances that each piece has a candle? I'm interested to ask your intuition, Brady. What is the probability of each piece having a candle?
Feels like it's going to be 50-50.
Why? I know I'm asking you why you're operating a camera, and that's always tough, but...
It feels like the cut should be 50-50.
Like what about the cut?
It feels like when you average out where all the cuts happened after a zillion cuts...
The average is in the middle. I agree. And actually, that's true of the candles, too.
Yeah.
But that makes it slightly less intuitive because they're all averaging to the same place now. So the thing I like about this puzzle is that at first glance to me, and I'm a mathematician, but I'm not an A-grade mathematician. I'm a maths teacher, really. It feels to me, at first glance, I don't know how to start. I don't know how to start putting numbers on this other than my intuition. And a lot of people say 50% to me. They think that's... So your intuition is like other people's.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Is it possible to cut the candle? I'm assuming it's impossible to cut the candle.
I think that's a good assumption. And I love working with you, Brady. You're an excellent mathematical modeler. You are aware of the complications that could get involved, and you decide to make things simple. Now, once we solve this one, we could start having non-infinitely small point candles and do it. But I suggest we don't bother yet. This is what mathematical modeling is all right. Let's keep it simple until we've sorted the simple one out. That's the puzzle. If you haven't already paused the video and you want to think about it, now's a good time. What I'd like to do for this one is solve it in more than one way. And that's kind of the point I wanted to talk about here, is that mathematicians solve things in more than one way. And that's almost always what makes some profound insight occur. Because if you can see it from one perspective and another perspective, you've got like a joining up at the back. And that's a nice moment. So we're going to try that in this one. Other piece of problem solving advice, and for you as well, that if you're stuck on something, try a simpler puzzle. So if I took one of the candles away, my question has now no meaning, right? What are the chances we get a candle on each piece? Obviously, can't happen. So, candle goes on, and I cut somewhere randomly. What are the chances it's on the left? The candle.
50-50.
It's got to be 50-50. It feels like there's symmetry all over the place. They're both random. And actually, the easy way to answer that, I think, is an ordering idea. Either the candle comes first, or the cut comes first. And there's no reason why one should be more than the other. So you've got to go 50-50. That gives us a clue for our first way of solving the problem. Hey, if we want to split this into three ways to solve this problem, here's part one, ordering. So ordering solved the simpler version. It was either the candle first or the cut first. So why don't we try some ordering argument? And this is where I probably have to write some things down. C for candle?
Yep.
Oh, do I differentiate between the two candles? This is the other problem mathematicians have, is like, do I need to model them as different? And we've got two candles that look identical. So I'm just going to say they're indistinguishable. So let's say the candle could come first, and then the other candle, and then the cut. That would be one way of ordering the outcome.
What are you going to call a cut?
We could use like a V shape for a cut, or a K.
K for knife?
Yeah. I mean, it's an annoying initial letter to use, frankly.
I like K for knife, because a K is what is strike in baseball as well, so.
That is one possibility. I think this is where your instincts from the simpler one kick in. You realise, well, there are other possibilities, and they don't feel like there should be any more likely or less likely, because these are all random. Candle, candle, cut. Cut with a K is now going to be in my head forevermore. What else could happen, Brady? And this is where I'm patronising.
You could do the knife and then the two candles.
Yeah, and that doesn't feel like less likely or more likely. Is there another option?
Yeah, you could do a candle a knife and a candle.
And that's the one that sort of answers the question I started with, is that's the only time we're going to get a candle on each piece. And since all of these are equally likely, although I haven't done a strong sort of careful argument for that, but it feels like it's believable that one should be not more likely than the others, which means that we get a third for that, a third for that, and a third for that. I now think this is one way of claiming that the answer to what are the chances we get a candle on each piece is a third. Which isn't a million miles from your 50%. But what I liked...
It's quite a way.
Well, I'm trying to be kind. The intuition for the single candle one, however stupid a question it is, it feels like a dumb question, but it's much more strong intuition for me that that's 50%. And then when you upgrade to two, you feel like, well, maybe it's less likely. And so if I'd given you the chance, I'm sure you'd have come down. Anyway, maybe that's right, and maybe it's not. There's another way to solve this, which maybe feels a bit more mathematical. But the key to this one is that each of those options was equally likely. Otherwise, you can't make an argument. I guess we should mention that there's a danger in every probability question about this. Like, what's the chance you win the lottery? One argument says you either win or you don't. So it's 50-50, right? And obviously, the misconception there is that they're not equally likely. So whenever you're making an argument about probability from studying cases, you better check that they're equally likely, which I think we have done.
And that would have been the same if we numbered the candles. We had candle one and candle two.
I'd forgotten about that, and you're right to pick me up on that. I'm glad you are. So let's say I did candle one, candle two, cut or knife, whatever we call it. Now we've got more options. So maybe if I mark these, right, that's a one, and these are the best numbers you've ever seen. Almost as good as my mice from a long time ago. Now there's another option, right? With the cut over there, I could have a candle two and candle one, and these would switch round. And that would be a different option. But by a similar argument, you might see where this is going, there's no reason to say that one's more likely than the other. And so actually, the other option you said, cut to candle, candle, could be these two. And you can see how this is going to pan out. And now we've got six options, each of which is equally likely, and two of them satisfy our condition. So I still think we're in a third. And it's nice to know that if you're worried about whether the candles matter, I know some of you are worried, it doesn't. The argument works both ways around. Hey, that's already two ways, and that was only part one. Method two, let's do another way of solving it, because if it comes up with the same answer, we're golden. If it doesn't, we've got to ask questions about at least one of the methods. So method two, I want to go mathematical on this. I said that these are three decisions. There's a candle, a candle, and a cut. Let's represent each one of those random things by a number. So candle one is a number between 0 and 1, uniform random distribution. Candle two is a number, 0 and 1. And the cut is a random number between 0 and 1, which tells me where it will land. Now, if you have two numbers, you could draw a two-dimensional picture of what could, like, you could have one dimension and the other dimension for the other number. So if you have three numbers, like in our case, we need to draw a three-dimensional picture of the outcomes. And actually, what I'm talking about is a possibility space, but it's going to be a three-dimensional picture. If I start drawing it on here, being able to draw in 3D is a surprisingly useful skill for a mathematician. And I'm not doing a geometry problem here, but I'm drawing a probability space. So that's X, Y, and Z. Z, if you're in England. And let's say X is candle one, Y is candle two, and let's say Z be the knife. Somewhere between 0 and 1 on this axis, somewhere between 0 and 1 on this axis, and somewhere between 0 and 1 on that, will describe the situation we end up. So what we've actually got is a cube. And any arrangement we've got here is a point within the cube. I mean, I can hold one, right? So a point in this cube represents the outcome of our randomness. And we can simulate this nicely on JoJoBra.
Of course.
Of course, I really like JoJoBra as a sort of tool for tinkering. And what I did here was I drew my cake, and I've got a line that I can cut. So I can choose where the cut goes, I can choose where candle one goes, and I can choose where candle two goes. And you can see that over on the right, it's moving things around. So actually, let's make this spin a bit so we can see what's going on. The x-axis for candle one, the y-axis for candle two, and the vertical axis for the knife, and all three measurements give you where the point is in space. If I put the cut somewhere in the middle and the candle over on the left here, can you see that this point I'm representing in the 3D space is gone bold? And I've got a little announcement here saying cut is between candles. You can see that from the cake, but if I put the other candle over here, it hasn't gone bold. So basically, there's a whole region of the cube where we've got a success, and there's a region of the cube where we haven't got a success. So I'm just going to color in the cube the points where the cut is between the candles. And I think you might be able to see where this is going in terms of get a probability out of it, because the entire space is all the possibles. And those two regions, it's necessary to spin this to see what those regions look like. You can imagine that those are the regions where the knife is in between, and it's really narrow in the middle. If the candles are close together, there's not a big region, and it's wide and the candles are further apart. So the only question now is, what volume of the cube is shaded? What proportion? It's not trivial, but it's also not that difficult, particularly if I spin one of these regions without turning. I promise you I'm not transforming. I'm just going to spin it around. And we get a square-based pyramid, in fact. That's occupying one side of the cube and going to a point. In fact, here's a cube, right? And if I pull one of these off, this is the shape we've just made. Now, the way I've configured it, it didn't automatically turn into this shape, but it is that volume. And I don't know if you remember the volume of a pyramid, Brady. There's no reason why you should.
So base times height?
Base times height gives you the volume of a cube.
A cuboid. And then what, do you a third?
It is a third.
Yeah.
And this cube was volume one. So this volume is a third. Which is a relief, because that's the number we got earlier. And what we've done is we've proved this in two different ways. We've done it by an ordering argument from our paper earlier, and ordering in space, not time. And we've done it by a geometry argument, which is the volume of a cube. Now, the one catch is, what if you didn't know the volume of a pyramid? And so here's my point about solving things in two ways. What I like about this by accident is that we're solving a probability problem. We did it with ordering, and we do it with geometry. And if I don't know what the volume of a square-based pyramid is, I can prove it to you by probability. I'm saying the answer is a third, so the volume of this shape is, in fact, the third of a cube. And hey, a proof of the volume of a square-based pyramid via a cake-cutting exercise. This is a serious point. If you can solve things in more than one way, you have two perspectives, and that's quite often a moment of profound insight. Like, that's when mathematicians get excited. You have two different ways of looking at a problem. Worth mentioning, there's another way of proving these fit together to make a full thing, and there's three of them. If I lock them together, these are 3D printed, then they obviously make a cube. Now, that's not a mathematical proof, but it's pretty hard to argue that those three shapes do make a cube, and therefore, if they're identical, they are a third each. So we've done the two different ways, but I promise there was deep water here. Maybe this isn't so deep. It's a profound moment to do things from two ways, but there's at least another way of doing this, and a glimpse of why questions like this are maybe more dangerous than you want them to be. I'm going to refer to something which you talked about with Grant in a recent video about Bertrand's paradox, and how thinking about cake led me on to thinking a lot about what you and Grant talked about. So the third way of solving this, and this is a nice thing for all mathematical problems, is instead of theorizing, just do it. So you're going to record 1,000 takes of me. Just no, we're not going to do it. The trouble is, this is where you start noticing, how would you actually pick a random point for the candle without like a random number generator? It's a pain. So without cutting the cake and spoiling our tea break later, we'll simulate it, what mathematicians might call a Monte Carlo method. But we'll simulate it, because if it doesn't give us a third, we start to doubt all the theory, which we've carefully proven twice. So let's simulate it. So apologies for the crudity of this model. I feel like I'm quoting Doc Brown there. But this one's not a scale model of Hill Valley. This is a scale model of a rubbishy rectangular cake. I've got two tiny candles on here and a cut. And all it's going to do, if I click on one of the buttons here, is just going to pick random positions for each of them. And you can see this one, there's a cut just in between the candles, success, and it's going to count them. And I'm not going to keep clicking, I'm just going to let it go. This isn't rigged, but it's done 50 odd trials now. It's not doing super quickly, but we've got a success rate ticking away up here that is relievingly, to me as a mathematician, settling around about a third. Now, I wouldn't expect it to be really tight on a third until I've done thousands. And it actually always surprises me when I do models how long it takes to converge on what theory is. Even if I believe the theory, it takes a long time for randomness to back it up. But it's not bad. I mean, this feels like I have rigged it, but it's settling about 0.34. But this is backing us up, which is a relief. So the two ways of solving it don't feel like they've had any crisis of conscience. And the experiment, however computery modeled it is backing us up, slightly above a third at the moment. The trouble is, when we upgraded this problem from sticks to cake, it feels very natural for me to then, in my head, upgrade from linear cake to a proper cake. So I started asking the question, what happens if you do this on a square cake or a round cake, which feels much more traditional? And I scared myself slightly.
If you'd like to see Ben scaring himself with a proper cake, check out the links to part two of this video. They'll be on the screen and in the description. Or if you'd like to just see more number file videos about stuff getting cut, well, let's just say that's a topic we've covered before.
Cutting a round cake on scientific principles.
I mean, there's more to a cake than just size. Some people like the sort of crusty bit around the outside.
Again, links in all the usual places.